Welcome to episode 268 of the Crowject podcast. Thank you to our sponsors, Trojan Aluminium and ARC General Maintenance. Now, it's not just me tonight, but I am only joined with one other person again, and it is Sophie. Welcome, Sophie. I'm very, very well. Soph, how are you?
I'm better than I was last week when I was supposed to be here.
Exactly. Didn't slip on anything this week and damage any knees?
No, I don't. I can't confirm if my ACL or any of the CLs or Ls in my knee are intact because, you know, country people are a bit stubborn. They don't like going to get things checked. Yeah, so we're just vibing it out, you know? I can walk on it. I'm not a professional sports person. I feel like a ligament is not a crucial, it's optional, you know?
It's a cruciate ligament, not a crucial
ligament. Not a
ligament.
Crucial ligament, exactly. So you're right. I think that they're optional, and that's what we're running with.
Sounds about right. As long as you can walk, what else do you need a knee for? You know, it's going to heal.
Absolutely.
It's absolutely fine. And I subscribe to the fact that Ray isn't here after making comments about you, and you've just magically turned up next week, your knee's all fine, and Ray's just disappeared. So,
no comment.
Whatever happened to Ray, he's in our thoughts and prayers.
Absolutely. I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, no, nothing. Nothing suspicious whatsoever.
Definitely not.
So, of course, we are here to discuss the big win against the Western Bulldogs. Who saw that coming?
Not most of us, apparently.
No, indeed. I was refound to the fact that we were going to lose by at least 6 goals, and we turned out to win by 6 goals, so that was nice. But don't spoil the result, actually. We'll get into that in just a second. Of course, we'll go through the results, the listeners' feedback, and all of the news around the club, and we have a little bit this week. Thank you, as always, to our amazing Patreons. If you want to become a Patreon, head to patreon.com/Crowject. And, of course, to hear our pre-rolls and segment street afterwards, where we'll have Around the Grounds and much more, head to patreon.com/Crowject and sign up for as little as $1 a week. Now, Soph.
A month, even.
A month. Even cheaper. A quarter of the price.
Wow.
Now, what happened yesterday at the Adelaide Oval, Soph?
We had a fantastic game. The Crows finished on 17 goals, 9, 111 to the... That's supposed to say dogs, not cats. Come on, Ben.
It's raining dogs, cats and dogs.
9 goals, 18, 72. And, of course, we saw a plethora of goals kicked by one man in particular, Darcy Fogarty, kicking 5. We will get to him a little bit later.
Indeed, we'll try and keep him quiet in the corner of the studio here if you're watching on the YouTube version.
He's just given me the fend-off situation, or the fog-off, should I say. We've got Keezy, who kicked 3. Filthy. Rochelle and Curtin with 2, and Walker, Rankin and Dawson with single goals.
Indeed. It was a very nice spread of goals.
It was a good spread of goals.
Everyone got involved, and that was really nice, including Dan Curtin, which was great to see.
That was beautiful.
So selections for this game, Billy Dowling went out omitted, which was a choice.
Yeah, you could say that.
It was, but a young body maybe needed a rest. Yeah. Was starting to, you know, peter off a little bit into the end of the year, so
yeah,
it's okay.
I get it. I think the fans would have been a lot more happier with it if maybe it said managed rather than omitted.
Yeah.
That might have gone a little bit better with the fan base.
Yeah.
But someone had to make room for Rankin.
Exactly right. His replacement was pretty handy.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's okay. It's okay. It'd be interesting to see if he comes back this week because he dominated the SANFL down West Adelaide. Adelaide Oval against West Adelaide.
Yes, Ben.
So we'll see. We'll see if he comes back in, though I don't know who would go out. But yeah, as we said, a very well-rounded performance. And it leads me to one question. Where the hell has it been for the rest of the year?
Well, I think we've had a few games throughout this year, which makes us ask that exact same question.
Mm-hmm.
I think we've just been very unlucky with the sequence of players that we've had missing throughout the year and the timings of them, like having certain players missing at the same time, which really hasn't helped us.
Yeah.
And when they have been key players who completely changed the look and feel of the team, I think that's probably where those poor performances have come from when we've missed them out on the field.
Yeah.
I think we saw a major difference just with Rankin's presence out on the ground.
Yeah. Just his pace and his electricity.
We have missed that speed so much.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was really, really good to see him back doing what he does best.
Indeed. So yeah, so who impressed for you? I have Shoal written down here because almost had a heart attack when the Crows posted the graphic this morning. I hadn't looked at the stats. He had 34 touches yesterday.
He did. And he had the highest 646 metres gained.
Yeah. If you'd asked me last night straight after the game, I would have been like, oh, maybe 20 if he was lucky. He's gone and had 34, which is...
25 of those were kicks, mind you.
Yeah, which makes it even worse that I didn't really notice him. He just had a few cheapies and just didn't really notice him running around, really. But
I find that if you don't notice a player, though, it means that they're doing something good because you only really tend to notice the mistakes a lot of the time. Yeah. So the fact that you don't notice someone and they've done that well, it's kind of like, okay, you're doing all right. It's
compliments to him, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I also thought Keys, he started very well. Obviously, it only took us like 20 seconds to get our first goal, which was amazing. It took me a minute to just like blink and I'm like, oh, what? Hang on. Yep.
And a score review went in his favour at that end of the ground, which is cool.
I nearly had it on because I was videoing at that time. And if I just moved my phone camera a tiny bit to the right, you would have actually seen it and I would have had a better angle than the arc. But, you know, I messed that up. But it's fine because they made the right decision.
Exactly
so
right.
It's all good.
The umpire tried his best to pay it a point. He was very certain that, you know, it had not been, well,
not been
probably been touched and gone over. But, yeah, we got there in the end, which was nice.
Yeah, poor Keezy. He's having a bit of a run this year of a few decisions that have had to go upstairs and a bit of trauma for us. But it's fine. I also, after Keys got our first goal, a couple minutes later, he was down in defence. He did like a good chase down tackle and also stopped them from pretty much getting a goal.
Yep.
That being said, they did like 30 seconds later then get a goal themselves. But it would have been a goal had he not laid that tackle and put that pressure on. So that was really good.
Exactly.
He ended up with 3 goals in the end. So
yep.
After a bit of a quieter week previously, I felt like he was back to his best.
Indeed, putting the pressure on all over the ground, front of the ground, back of the ground.
He's just everywhere. I also really liked Worrell.
Yep.
And Keane. I thought both of them did fairly well in the back lines.
Yeah, that was Keane's best game in quite a while. We were talking last week about his sort of fall off in form, but it was nice to see him holding marks and you know, playing an opponent well.
Yeah. Again, Worrell was one that's obviously missed a chunk of games this year, and you definitely noticed when he wasn't in the side, so definitely love to have him back there.
We struck up conversation about Worrell yesterday in his arm sleeve or his forearm sleeve.
Yes.
We feel like he should go the whole arm. Oh. It doesn't look quite as good as just the forearm. You know, you saw Cody Waitman, he's got it pretty much full arm. Worrell, it just, you know.
Yeah, no, I rate that. I rate the full arm sleeve. That would be good.
Yeah. I mean, you know, if you're going to go the whole arm.
Exactly. Go the full way. I also had Rob.
He was good.
He was very good.
What was it, 53 hitouts to 17 or something like that against Tim English, which, I don't know, before the game we were sort of looking at it and going, oh, he's about to get towed up all over the ground. But he was good.
He was good. He laid 3 tackles late, like, since the bye, since he got dropped.
Yep.
Now that he's come back to the AFL, he is putting a lot more effort in around the grounds. There's a lot more chasing and tackling.
Yeah.
And he's actually got like a little bit of speed to him. You don't realise that he can actually move when he wants to.
Yeah, he's a bit sneaky fast sometimes, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't happen a lot, but like sometimes it kind of catches you off guard. And I think that's how he's getting these sneaky tackles, because players don't expect him to chase.
Yeah.
And then he does, and they're like, oh, shit.
That was it in the last quarter yesterday when he was chasing Libba and someone? I think the Dogs had an outnumber towards
one of them.
Where you sit, that side of the ground. I think it might have been Libba, but yeah, he didn't stop them fully, but it was
he tried.
Two midfielders going past him, and he's about to get blown past, but he did
actually,
pretty well.
Yeah, he made an impact of some sort.
Yeah.
He had 8 score involvements, which
that's
is
impressive.
Not bad. 7 kicks to only 4 handballs.
That would be worrying if you told me that before the game. But
exactly. It actually worked out somewhat good.
Again, didn't notice.
Exactly. So that's great. What else? Yeah, 58 hitouts.
Yeah, that's...
That's monstrous. That's
big numbers.
And
I think Bevo actually made mention of it in his press conference, I think. He basically said that Tim English got absolutely monstered in the ruck, which is... unlucky.
Indeed. That's about all I had. Did you have anyone else that you thought was performing well?
That's probably about it. Like, it was another one of those games where everyone just played well. I think Curtin. We'll move on to Daniel Curtin because he was the man of the fourth quarter. Obviously, mm-hmm. kicked two goals and probably saved himself a little bit because his first few quarters around the ball, especially, he looked a bit lost.
Yeah.
We were sort of watching him off the back of the pack, and you know he was in a lot of centre bounces, which was good.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't fooled that stat out for a few weeks. I'm sure the listeners are very, very happy with that.
What, the CBAs?
Yeah, the attendances.
Would you like me to go through them? Because I've written them down.
Absolutely.
So Rob attended 26, Crouch 22, Berry 17, Curtin 13.
Yeah.
Dawson 13, Rankin 10, Taylor 6, Lego 3, Filthy 2. There is someone missing from that list that I'm going to get to very shortly.
I'm sure we will hear about him a lot very shortly. But yeah, I think Daniel Curtin and Nick came out today and said we don't really know where we want him to play and we haven't really figured it out. It was pretty evident that we're not sure yet.
Yeah.
And he can just be a bit of a swingman. So
he can.
He's the new Andy Otten.
Oh, brilliant. Just
a lot more athletic.
Oh, dear. Yeah. The only worrying thing is I don't know, like, if you keep chopping and changing his position, is that going to affect his confidence and confuse the poor guy?
Yeah, yeah.
Trying to get comfortable in a solid position, but, like, one week you're playing defence, next week you're forward. That's, I don't know.
Real 2021 Darcy Fogarty, play him on fullback on Liam McBean to, you know, grow his game and chuck him in the midfield and then put him up forward and then move him back to down back and
That was a tough year.
That was a real tough year. Thankfully, that's a long way behind us. And now,
look where we are.
Exactly. With that, Tex was subbed out halfway through at the end of the third quarter after Tim English poked him in the eye, the dog.
Literally dog.
Quite literally the dog. We'll get to that in a moment because it's come out what has actually happened to him.
It was a bit of a slap in the face.
It quite literally was a bit of a slap in the face.
Thanks, Cream.
Summed it up absolutely perfectly. Just gave him a bit of a poke in the eye and he was off and done for the rest of the game and maybe a little bit longer.
Maybe.
It was a crowd of 39,000, which I was very impressed with when they announced that.
That wasn't bad. Yeah. I did the guess before. Like, the Crows put up the thing on Twitter about guess the crowd to win the whatever it was this week.
Yeah.
My goodness, the amount of people who cannot read. They've written there, enter here with an arrow pointing to a link. There was like 20 to 30 people replying in the comments with their guesses.
Yeah. You know, people don't read.
And the week before, the Crows account tweeted a second time being like, just a reminder to use the link.
Shout out to the media team. Oh, you guys are the real MVPs because there's...
Had no words, honestly.
That should be a good thing, though, because there's less people entering.
That is true. So, but I had a bit of a wild guess. I think mine was like 44,000 or 46,000. I was just like, it's the last game of the year. Surely people are going to get up and about.
Good weather.
It was a beautiful day.
Yeah.
Stunning day for footy.
An absolute peach of a day.
But, you know, I mean, it's a decent crowd still. And honestly, we're doing better than a lot of Victorian teams who are in the hunt for finals. So I'm not complaining.
And that big, scary Big Four of Victoria that we were all told about earlier in the year that have actually fallen out of the top eight now. we'll get to that a little bit later on in Around the Grounds in Segment Street. But for now, shall we talk about a few of your favourite players?
Oh, absolutely, we should.
I'll let you drive this. Who do you want to go first?
Let's do the man of the hour / week / every day.
Bog.
That's very loud. Bog. Bog. Oh, is this one? Worked it out. Okay.
Now we're cooking with gas.
Absolutely. Darcy Fogarty. Big 100 games for the big man.
Indeed. Let's give that a clap.
Just a clap. All the things happening here.
1500 buttons.
I've got the iPad. I've got the whatever your mixer thing. I've got my notes. It's all happening. Darcy Fogarty, 100 games. And didn't he turn it on?
He did.
He was amazing.
He was ready for the big stage.
Now, statistics-wise, it doesn't look like a massive game.
Yeah.
9 disposals, but 9 score involvements. Every touch resulted in a score, which is not bad.
Indeed.
Obviously, he himself kicked 5 goals, 1. Stunning. You love to see it. equaling his highest personal best as well. Couldn't quite get a sneaky handful. Not handful, half a dozen. But, you know, it's fine.
He might have six fingers. We never know. He's a bit of a mystical man. He could be very special.
He could. He had 8 marks, 3 inside 50s. Just very proud.
Yeah.
It was just a very wholesome game to watch. Like, the whole season he's just continued to grow and to reach such an amazing milestone. I know it's only 100 games, but still amazing.
Yeah.
And to perform in that way was just like, I was just so happy. Like, the whole game, every time he went near the ball, it just felt like something good was going to happen.
Yeah.
It was just awesome.
Yep. No, 100%. That's probably been his biggest improvement, is his impact on the game when mm-hmm. he maybe isn't necessarily kicking the goals. Yesterday he was, but even if he wasn't, he was still creating chances and doing things. And that was probably a thing where I was a bit of a knocker of him earlier mm-hmm. in the year where, you know, we had a bit of a rumble in here, a bit of a fight about Fog. punches were thrown and all sorts, but he's really improved that side of his game. And it's, you know, I don't think the worry is there as much as, last year when we were talking mm-hmm. about, oh, when Tex retires, if Tex leaves, what are we going to look like? Because we're okay. I think
we're going to be okay.
Indeed, we will. And, you know, despite what some individuals say, Jack Hudson, I think even with Tex in the side, he can still perform at this sort of level. You know, he's not holding back. It's okay.
We're all going to be okay.
Indeed.
And you know why else we're going to be okay?
Why is that, Soph?
Because my other man has gone back to defence. And he had a really, really good game. He did. You should have seen the glee on my face when I saw him warming up with the defenders pre-game. It took my brain a moment to be like, sorry, is this like 2018? Like, you haven't been doing the warm-up in front of me for like yonks. Like, are you lost? Are you okay? And then it kind of dawned on me, like, hang on a minute, he's not going to play in the midfield. And he didn't. He had 0 centre bounce attendances.
There you go. He still managed to have three clearances.
Yeah. 5 intercepts, 28 disposals, 4 tackles, 418 metres gained.
4 rebound 50s.
Oh my, he was just everywhere. It did feel like for a moment there that every time he touched the ball, he was giving away a free. And a lot of those frees were a bit, 50-50.
Yeah.
But it was at that stage of the game where the umpires were just like free kick Bulldogs any chance they could get. So, Yeah,
it's okay. We can give him a pass for that one, I think, because there was there were some shocking decisions there at the end of the second, early third. It was
yes, indeed.
Yeah.
But no, I think we saw that he doesn't have to play midfield all the time. Our midfield's going to be okay.
Yep.
Our forward line's going to be okay.
The kids are all right.
The defense is absolutely going to be okay.
The kids are all right.
The kids themselves are going to be okay. We just have to trust the process.
Indeed. I agree. There are a lot of green shoots and moving a few magnets around. Mm-hmm. It looked okay.
Yeah.
Now, shall we give our votes for the bungee medal, of which you said earlier you've only decided one of the three votes so far.
And I still haven't decided the other two, but we're going to roll with it. 3 votes. Is he going to write it down?
Oh, yeah, I will.
Darcy Fogarty.
Yep. No surprises.
Who would have thunk? Alrighty, 2 votes. I'm going to go Shoal.
Yep.
Because that was a very, very good game. And you know what? I'm going to do 1 vote to Rob.
Okay. That's very fair enough, I think.
But also, a commendable, is that the right word?
Honourable,
that's the one. Honourable mention to Keys, Worrell and Keane.
Yeah, that's fair.
Very tough to choose.
It was a very well-rounded performance.
It
was,
yes.
Now, I have also gone Fog for the 3, so the man gets his respect in game 100. He gets the 3 votes. My 2 I'm giving to Jordan Dawson.
Okay. He was here and I crossed his name out because I was like, nah.
And I think he's a victim. Ray and I were talking about this last week. Is because his ceiling is so high and we expect just the exceptional from him all the time, he probably doesn't get the recognition because we're like, oh, yeah, that's just what he does.
Yeah.
So I'm going to give him the two, mm-hmm. and I'm going to give Shoal the one for me, okay. because he was, you know, even though I might not have noticed him at the time, he was doing a lot of stuff.
Sure.
Which means Fog gets the three, Lockie Shoal gets the two, and Dorse gets the one with two votes in total. Shout out to Rob, who was just out the back there after scoring a vote last week.
I only did it for Elodie. Yeah, well, she's not here. Somebody had to do it.
If she turned up, he probably would have got a vote. So, you know, if you want Elodie to return to this podcast, write in.
This is all on Elodie. This is not my fault.
100% it is. And, you know, maybe if you want Elodie back, you can give us a call on 8246-5498 and say, we want Elodie back. And we will make sure she's here. And as a beautiful segue, let's jump onto the voice messages, which we had a few. We did have a few sent in this week.
Yes, and we did.
As we've said, if you want to give us a call at literally any time, it doesn't even have to be if you want Elodie back. Maybe you don't want Elodie back. Maybe you can just say, just don't put her on again. Say she missed the big week of Rob's good game. Just don't bring her back.
Yeah, where is she? Is she back in the country yet?
Yes, yeah, she was at the footy yesterday, sat in the Western stands.
Yes, that's true. Ellie, where are you?
Just, I don't know, most likely working, let's be perfectly honest. Yeah. But yeah, if you have any feedback about the games, if it's quarter time, if it's half time, if it's after the game of the showdown this week and you just want to hang shit on port no matter the result, call us on 8246-5498. I'm sure it'll be a bumper episode with calls next week. But for now, let's jump to the feedback from this week.
Perfectly timed, Benny. Here we go.
There's a bit happening here. I don't think there's a...
Hang on. Very good analysis. I liked it.
Can't say I disagree.
No, definitely not. Let's try this one.
Rob. Everybody. Everybody. 11 disposals. 4 marks and 3 tackles. 58 hit out. First team English only got 16. What? Rob. Everybody.
Yo, Fogarty kicked 5 goals. What a big old green boat. That's pretty good. I'm good. And scene. And
scene. Okay, that escalated quickly and ended quickly.
Dave pops up everywhere.
He literally pops up out of nowhere. We love you, Dave.
And I'm so sorry, Elodie. I doubted you that you weren't going to be here for Rob's big game, and she rocks up in the voice messages.
She rocks up anyway. Amazing. You asked and she delivered.
Fan-fucking-tastic win. Boys and girls can't fucking complain about that one iota. Key point, Fog, 100th game, 5 goals, fucking well-deserved. Keys had a cracker game, Daddy Dawson as well. And how fucking good is it getting a full game into fucking Dan Curtin and watching him fucking break the game apart in that last quarter? This is what we've been fucking begging for. Great stuff. The future looks bright. Can't fucking complain about anything. Well done.
Absolutely.
There was a lot of fuckings in that. A lot of fuckings in that. And
very
I respect
well deserved.
I appreciate the fact that we have gone out of the overcast part of the year and the sun is starting to rise again and the future is once more bright, because at times this year...
The fog is lifting.
Exactly.
The fog is lifting.
The fog is lifting and it's, you know, it's a beautiful day.
Absolutely. We have one more. Friend of the pod. Host of the pod.
Cream, isn't it?
I don't know what this is going
to be. Hey guys, what a fantastic win that was. I think that's the kind of four-quarter effort we've been looking for all year, and they still put their cue in the rack late on the pace and managed to find some positives with Dan Curtin kicking 2 goals late, which was great to see. I mean, the Bulldogs, what do you say about them? They tried to be more embarrassing than Rachel Gunn at the Olympics. Didn't get anywhere near it, but they were still pretty bad. But, fuck, Rachel Gunn, what a joke, eh? Imagine... training 4 years just to come out and lay on the ground and roll around like your having some kind of fucking fit. I mean, that's just genuinely embarrassing. So, fingers crossed, he never goes anywhere near LA in 4 years. But the Crows can go places next year. I think they're competitive against the good teams. We know that. They've lost games that they should win. They've had some close losses this year. I'm being optimistic. I think definitely a massive chance this week, even with Tex out.
Hey, don't spoil the news.
Port, I mean, this is the time of year. It's only a couple of weeks till finals where we expect them to shit the bed. So who knows, maybe they'll start a couple of weeks early, because we're on three showdown wins on the trot. So fingers crossed they can make it four. But yeah, no, a great game all round on the weekend, and go Crows.
Well said.
Thank you so much.
And I think Cream will be very pleased to know that breakdancing was removed from the Olympics before the next one. So she won't be in LA.
Can I just say, though, it is very much the Australian culture for us to have now embraced her as an absolute icon.
Did you see her at the closing ceremony?
No, I haven't seen any of that.
It was going nuts. Like, the whole Australian team was just getting around her. They, like, did a dance circle with her in the middle. Oh,
that is amazing. Like, originally, a lot of people were like, oh, my gosh, I'm so embarrassed, and were, like, hanging a lot of shit on her. But it is such an Aussie thing to take those instances and just make them iconic.
Yeah, yeah, 100%.
And that's just what she is now. She's an Aussie treasure.
Exactly. No one's ever going to forget about breakdancing at the Olympics for this reason. So
exactly. She's actually done a good thing for the sport. But now they're like, actually, let's get rid of that. Mistakes were made. But yet we won't have netball, but it's fine.
I think we have cricket at the next Olympics.
Do we?
I think so.
Oh, that's going to go off.
Maybe. There's a few new sports coming in. I'm pretty sure cricket's coming in. But
well, that's exciting.
Yeah, another gold for us. Why not?
Yeah, absolutely.
Simple stuff. India who? New Zealand who? Australia for gold. Now, we will also jump over to feedback, general feedback from all of you lovely listeners listening at the moment. I will start by pulling up Facebook.
It's in the chat.
Thank you very much, Sophie. Let me just pull up the chat real quick. And I will get the feedback here. There's a few bits and pieces from around the place. Mark McInerney. Oh, here we go. This is a topic that has been very prevalent in our Patreon's chat, which if you want to head to patreon.com/Crowject, you can get yourself into. He has asked the question, has Tex played his last game of AFL? What do you think, Soph?
Well, to put it simply, there was a reply from a Mark Tex who just said no.
I take him as a Tex fan.
Yes. I mean, the display picture may also give that one away, but simply no.
Yeah, I tend to agree. Mm. And I think the delay of the contract is just a bit of a coincidence rather than a, you know, pushing it down the road, what's going to happen, not sure. I just can't see a world where he leaves.
No.
And I don't think he should.
No.
And I don't think we should push him out either. There was a big discussion in the Patreon chat earlier this week, of which it felt like I was fighting a very one-sided battle against about 15 people.
Yes.
He's earned the right to call his career when he wants. Okay, we're not going to have him running around when he's 45 years old. No. Obviously, if it gets to that point, we probably give him a cut. But yeah. He kicked 72 goals last year.
Yeah.
And it's not like he's been horrible this year.
No. He's still given something.
Exactly right. So if the King wants to hang around for one more year, he can hang around for one more year.
Just because he gets another year doesn't mean that he plays constantly either.
Exactly.
And I feel like hopefully he does sign on for one more year, but I think he will probably be playing the amount of games that we probably expected from him this year. It was just unfortunate that Filthy went down quite early and for quite a long period of time, that he ended up playing more games than what we probably thought he should this year.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think he's still got plenty to offer to the club and the group on field and off field that I think it's worth him getting one more year.
100%. 100%.
And seeing how he goes and calls it when he's ready.
Yeah. No, I 100% agree. Travis says, it's easy to win when there's nothing on the line. Well, I don't know about us. There was nothing on the line for us, but the Bulldogs are playing for a top four spot, Travis. So I think there was a bit on the line for them.
Their kicking was shocking, though.
that's been a trend recently. Yeah. There's a couple of Bulldogs friends that I was speaking to a couple of weeks ago that one of them tweeted, like, when are we going to learn to kick straight? And I was like, probably round 22 at the Adelaide level against us. And then Sam Darcy decides to kick 2 goals 5 because
was
he...
Was it 1-5?
No, he kicked a late one.
Why was everyone saying 1-5?
I think it was 2-5, wasn't it? He kicked one early and then he ran into an open goal with about 5 minutes to go.
Let me check.
Or did he kick one?
No, he kicked 1-5.
Ah, I thought he kicked 2. Well,
no, Bont kicked 2. He was the only one to kick 2.
Okay, I thought he kicked 1 early. Well, no. He kicked 1-5, which is even more embarrassing. and his one goal was from about 2 metres out running into an open goal late. Yeah. So there was that. But yeah, they had a lot to play for. Like, they are fighting in a dogfight for a spot in the finals in the top 4. So plenty to play for there, Travis. John says, a great team performance. Best game Robbers played all year. That's a tick. Backs were great. Mids were great. And our 3 tall forward line of Tex, Filthy, and the 5-goal Foggin, Rankin. Oh, fuck, this is a long sentence. Hold on, let me restart that.
I'm just going to keep ticking.
And our 3 tall forward line of Tex, Filthy, and the 5-goal Fog with Rankin and Rash back to form. Great. Curtin getting a full game and kicking 2 was icing on the cake. Bring on the showdown.
Absolutely.
Bang. Maddie says, Crom are a far, far better side when Crouch plays, then even better when Rankin plays. Without trying to state the obvious, Bond is a cracker also. He's coming in great.
He's amazing.
Cody Waitman in his pocket this week. He's just takes the best small forward and just says, you know what, you're not going to kick a goal today.
I got this, guys. It's fine. Just leave it with me.
I don't care what form you're in.
Yeah.
Not today.
He's legit the opposite Paul Pleasure.
He is.
I keep saying, but like when he's running away from me and I just see the 40, I'm just like, that's just a mini Paul Pleasure.
It just takes you back to the dream days.
It really does.
Kevin says, only capable of winning games that are of no consequence. Okay. Gail says, not the end of season yet. 2 very important games to go. Play for pride and to make finals harder for the opposition. Well, we can certainly put a big dent in these last 2 teams.
We definitely can. I think we're just playing for shits and gigs now.
We are.
Like, let's just mess people up. We've got nothing to lose.
Exactly. Exactly right. We just want to fuck around. Port, you want a top 4
spot?
And
they'll find out.
You're going to, you know, yeah, exactly. You're going to find out. Sydney, you could be playing for top spot in that last round. We don't give a fuck. We do not care.
Except Ben is going to the game and he doesn't have a great record, so.
look, I'm probably about 50-50 with my, I'd be about 50-50. The first 5 away games I went to were wins.
Were they?
And then I don't think I've been to a win since. I don't think. My last win that I went to was North away in 2021 at Marvel Stadium.
That's grim.
And even then I ate a dim sim on the road trip back and got sick. So I don't even know if that is counted as a win. Horsham truck stop. Not a good time. Throwing up on the side of the freeway. No, just bad. Bad.
Bad.
Mark has commented saying, sadly for Knicks, he'll still be sacked surely.
Oh my gosh.
David has responded to him and said, no, he won't. Mark says, I think he's gone. They'll do a thorough season review and he'll get tapped. That's an interesting point of view. Jerry has just given us a plain old thumbs up.
You love to see it.
It's just simple, Jerry. Simple. I can't tell if this is... Matt is a frequent commenter on our posts, and I think this is sarcasm. Maybe, but I can't tell. He says, sack Knicks. Fogarty is shit. Rob is no good. Murphy is crap. Our midfields suck, and we don't have a Bont and Pelly type player, etc., etc. Blah, blah, blah. It's called hard work. The team is fine. Yes, maybe missing an A-grader, but we ain't that far off. Okay, I didn't read the last sentence before saying all that stuff. So I apologize, Matt. You are a very intelligent individual, much more than a lot of people in the comments saying sack Knicks, genuinely.
Indeed.
Now, Sophie, what have you got over there?
I'm going to take Instagram. So on the stories, we've just got a few responses after the win. There's a lot of fog. Amazing. Can't believe the crowd voted for Mr. Brightside to be played. Have we collectively healed?
What a fucking farce that
what
was.
What was that?
Yeah.
Who voted for that and why were you there?
That genuinely a piss take.
Why was it even an option to be played?
Yeah.
To be chosen? Who thought that was a good idea?
Yeah, there's 2 bones to pick with that one. Number 1, AFC, game day team, whoever picks those songs. What the fuck are you doing? Putting it as an option. And number two, the fans in the stands who have voted, yeah, I think I want to hear Mr. Brightside. No. That was a horrible moment and a great day. A great day otherwise.
The great day was absolutely ruined. All right, let's see. Frothing over fog. What a mood.
Yeah, facts.
Three crom wins in a day. Because the AFLW got up over Port. Port indeed. Still can't get a win in a showdown.
What's that, nine in a row?
Ben K is still the hottest. Yes, Claire.
Have you seen Fog?
Got to share it around, right?
It's very true.
Unexpected crom domination.
Crom-dom.
Crom-dom.
Yeah, that's a word I probably won't use again.
All right, let's very swiftly head over to the Instagram post itself. Dub. Yep. How good do the kids look? They look amazing.
Oh, fuck. Wrong one.
Oh, my goodness.
I did that blindly for everyone listening right now. I'm not a hater.
I'm just going to keep moving down to Twitter. We have got massive win, none better after Beveridge said last week he was starting to get real about their chances. This is an underestimated win against the Red Hot Doggies. Make no mistake, Crows are going to have a massive year next year. Knicks, for fuck's sake, keep the edge going. These boys are ready.
Keep the edge going.
Zeno says, where are all the haters now? First time this year they've been able to put a decent team together. Ranks, Murray, Worrell, Riley, all rusty. Whoa.
Huh?
Sorry? No to all of that. I'm sorry. Negatives.
Yeah, don't need to do that one blind.
Brad just says, in all caps, Dan Curtin, finally. Yes.
Indeed.
Look what happens when you play the kids. They do well. They kick goals. They dominate.
It's simple. Oh. It's a simple, simple game.
And that's about it, really. You went through all those Facebook notes, didn't you?
I did.
Yeah. So thanks for telling us your thoughts about the game.
Indeed. Of course, if you want to reach us on any of the socials, head to @Crowject, and you can get that on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok. YouTube, you can watch us. If you want to see what we're doing right now at this very moment, as we very kindly wave to you with Fog sitting in the corner. This is that.
High
that's
fives
a collision.
With Fog.
Bang. Just like that. Head to YouTube @Crowject. You can also go and watch our walk and talk, which was a very fun time yesterday after the game. I think it was a 40-minute video.
It was a 40-minute one. I haven't had time to watch it yet, but that's when I get home tonight. That's going straight on the telly.
Indeed, and it's always a fun time. I don't know if Pete's going this week to do it after the showdown. Probably not the safest idea after a Port home showdown, but he's a madman, so he may very well turn up.
You never know.
And of course, you can go back in the previous catalogue of all the other walk and talks.
There is a lot on there. A plethora, some might say.
A plethora. And that is not a double entendre, which is also a fantastic word, which we discussed in the pre-roll. As you mentioned before, voice messages on 82465498. Of course, we will listen to any that get sent through on the pod, barring appropriateness, of course. Don't say some things.
Don't talk for like 15 minutes.
Yeah, please, mate. Short, sharp, and shiny.
Yeah.
Like, a bit of a conversation's all right. I mean, it can't really be a conversation because you're talking with yourself.
It's a one-way conversation.
Yeah, exactly right. Just get to the point. Yeah.
just reasonable. I mean, we're still going to listen, and even if we don't play it in the main pod and it's a long one, you'll hear it at the very end of the pod anyway.
Exactly. So if you want to read the Australian Constitution, go for it, but don't expect it to be fully in the mid-pod. It'll be on here, but just at the end. If you want to read the Constitution, I don't know. You could probably
spend
your time doing
better
things.
Maybe you want to read the rule book to us so we understand the rules better.
Would that help
you
us understand the rules?
You can, but we're going to chuck it at the end of the pod.
Yeah, yeah. If you've got Matthew Nichols, the umpire, sitting there with you and you want to read him the rule book.
Oh, that would be good
you could
content.
Do that. That would be great content. I don't know if that would ever happen, but
it'd
be good
know.
Content. Someone like a Daniel Gorringe, I reckon, could get that to happen, I think.
Oh, yeah.
He's got the sort of power that could make that happen.
Yeah.
Might pitch that idea. Chuck him a DM later on. Anyway, as well, we just want to give a shout-out to our Patreons of $10 and above. If Soph would like to pull up the list, and thank you to everyone.
including Jenny McArdle, Hayden Arthur, a.k.a. The Real Hilf, Jordan Mahoney, Jessica Cook, Jake Bockhove, Drew Corner, Sam Curtis, Sean Marie Davies, Brendan McGarrigan, James Payne, Michael Bornholm, Simone McDonald, Jezza Withers, Paul David Clennett, Matt Roylance, Neil Roylance, and our new Patreons, Andrew Burse and Richard Sheath. And of course, if you join, you could also get a shout out.
Indeed, right at this moment of the
pod. At this moment.
If you had signed up in the last week, you would have heard yourself right now.
Exactly. So if you sign up now, we will read your name out next week.
And yeah, this time next week, when there's probably just two people sitting around this table again, because we seem to just struggle with numbers at the moment. It's a real intimate sort of pod, but we'll read out your name, and it's a small, tight group circle of friends.
We will celebrate you.
Indeed. You might even get a clap sound effect, if you like.
She's giving them out early.
She's giving them out, but it's very deserved. And of course, if you want to deck yourself out in Crom merch, which is modelled here on the table in front of us, you can get yourself a beanie, a scarf, and the beanies are new. We have a new variant of the Crom beanie, which includes the Crowject logo on the back, which if you're, again, watching the video version, can be seen here on the right of screen.
There is, but we do have some old ones left, and I've only got the old stock still, so we might just get a few of them out, and then the new ones will roll on in.
So you're getting an old one if you order right now, and it's not really up for debate. That's just what you're getting.
They're exactly the same. It's just you don't have the podcast name on them.
Exactly.
That's fine.
Basically, you can't promote us as much as you could with the new ones, but it's
exactly.
Okay. It's okay because we love you anyway.
I might swap them out. We don't know yet.
It could
be. It's a surprise.
Indeed.
You won't know unless you try.
Indeed. You should probably just buy five and just find out where you
get. Yeah. You never know.
You can also get air fresheners. You can get the lovely Solely Designs designs on T-shirts and jumpers.
You
not on signs.
You absolutely can. But yes. Not on signs. That was quite a costly... costly experience, that one.
But they look good.
They
and they get TV time.
They do get TV time, guys.
Proven. Multiple times this year, actually, they've had TV time. So if you want to get on TV,
yeah,
totally not guaranteed at all. Just buy one of the Solely Designed shirts and you'll be on there.
Again, you don't know unless you try.
Exactly right. I can't tell you what to do, but it's the only way to try it, is to buy it.
It's like a good version of Benny and the Bets. It's a good gamble because you get something from it.
You actually cannot
lose. You're actually
going
to win.
Exactly. You cannot lose because you get the product.
Exactly.
You don't get fucked by North Melbourne conceding three goals in 90 seconds to lose a multi. And that does happen on Benny and the Bets occasionally.
It does.
Or
and then
frequently.
Benny goes absolutely silent in the chat and you start worrying about his welfare.
I was actually at work at that time, which was a very pleasant experience.
That's even worse.
Anyway, moving swiftly on from there, we have some news. So our round 24 fixture against Sydney at the SCG, round 24 Sydney Saturday night, what could possibly go wrong? We never hated that fixture before.
No, of course not.
Has been locked in. It will be the Saturday night. So I think 7 p.m. Adelaide time, or if you're like me and heading across, 7:30 Sydney time.
Or if you're like me and going to be in Melbourne that weekend, then it will also be 7:30.
Exactly. So no matter where you are, the game will be played.
It will indeed.
At some time. So yeah, I actually don't know why I bought flights to this. I thought it may have been Texas last game. And
you were just like, I got to do it.
Jetstar had a sale on. I got my flights for like $108 each way. And I was like, That's pretty good. But we got GA seats to the game, so we're actually sitting at the Sydney and Cheer Squad end. Their set out's really weird. I don't know if you've been to the SCG or seen the ticketing map, but it's like a little bay of opposition supporters where the opposition runs out, and then like the whole other side of the ground is GA.
Right.
It's just a very odd thing. But
thoughts and prayers.
Indeed. I cannot wait. It'll be a new oval ticked off the bucket list, and hopefully Ben Keys kicks a goal late and just sinks their finals chance. Well, not their finals chances, but their top spot chances or something like that.
Stunning stuff that would be.
Indeed. Moving on, we'll stick with the AFL news and then move to AFLW. All right. Isaac Rankin has signed a 2-year extension, keeping him around the club until the end of 2027. So he still had a year to run on his current contract, but decided to extend. So congratulations to Isaac. We're very happy to have you around, and maybe one of your mates will be around with us very soon.
We can only hope.
Indeed. Fog, we're going to talk about Fog again because he came out in the media last night in a post-game interview and said that beating Port this week would be, what did he say? It was... You're about to pull out the direct quote. It was something like, it would be the cherry on top.
I have to pad for a minute.
All right, I will certainly pad the news here. We listened to the beautiful Darcy Fogarty on, I think it was ABC Radio last night, and his beautiful blue eyes. Fuck, I can't stop looking at his beautiful blue eyes. Talk about the showdown this week. And I think he said beating him this week would be incredible. Or, you know, putting a dent in their season would be incredible.
You're going to have to keep going because the internet is letting me down.
All right. Well, they were basically asking about the showdown. He said, I've got the quote here somewhere, to cost them their year would be unbelievable, and mentioned something about being the cherry on top. But I have questions about this quote, because the cherry on top of this season would indicate that we've had a good season.
Mm.
It's kind of like chucking a piece of glitter on top of a turd, if we're going to really talk about the results for this season. But it's nice to see the other side of town talking shit about the showdowns. Normally it's the, you know, Port Adelaide hate us, Ryan Burton's dad got fired, we hate the Crows, professional jealousy, blah, 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 that same bullshit.
Yes. I have found the direct quote. Finally, the internet has worked. So, Darcy Fogarty on possibly costing Port a top four spot with a showdown 56 victory. It'd be the cherry on top. It's huge, and it's going to be something we're going to try and do. To cost them their year would be unbelievable.
Indeed.
Indeed.
It's probably not the quote that I would run with a week out from it, because we're going to look real stupid if we lose, but he's stating the obvious. Like, there's, you know, of course that's the case. You know, we want to go out there and win regardless of who we're playing this week. Like, it's, people are going to beat that up and, you know, build it up, and if we lose, make fun of it and everything, but it's the obvious.
It's not like it's backfired when Port have done that or anything.
No, never. And I saw Jordan Dawson in his presser today. They asked him pretty much the same question, trying to prompt him for a similar response. And he was like, yeah, of course we're going to try and win. Like, you know, we don't want to lose. Like, actually, you guys can have top spot. We'd love to see you playing in a home final.
We would absolutely love you to do that.
Yeah, just get us corporate box seats or something like that when you're there. No, obviously we're going to try and win this week. Yeah. So, yeah, it's not really much of a point, but I just thought I'd put it in there because it's just great to hear Fog talk and
talk shit
at any time. Mm. I just want to see him run through someone this week.
Oh, my gosh. Him and Filthy in the forward line, just beast mode.
Yeah.
Stunning.
Just put it on their heads. We've seen what their big forwards do when one of our forwards is having a good game, knock themselves out to try and get off the field. I mean, let them kick 7 goals on them instead. Mm. So just feed them.
Yeah.
I want Fog to kick 6 or just something. Get his personal best,
mm-hmm,
and just absolutely ramp it home past Port.
That would be beautiful. The hill will be pumping.
It will be. There'll be many a chant going up on the hill if that were to happen, and I severely hope it happens because it's going to be a grim night if not.
Indeed.
On to AFLW news. Stevie Lee Thompson signed a new contract, I believe, Soph.
Yeah, she's signed on for one more year.
Indeed, indeed. The 34-year-old, 32-year-old, 34-year-old. So one of the veterans of the team now, still as quick as ever, as we saw absolutely last year, but exciting news heading into this new season.
Definitely. Just on the AFLW as well, make sure you get your tickets to the showdown, our first home, or not home game, it's a Port game, but our first game of the season.
Indeed.
Which is the 31st of August.
Of August, indeed.
To say.
And Ebony Marinoff has come out and said to cost them their season would be incredible. Actually, would be the cherry on top.
It would actually be the cherry on top to start our season that way.
Indeed. Well, Port are playing their grand final in round one, because let's be perfectly honest, they're not going to do anything. Their team's just not that good. But good to see that in the trial game we played against them on the weekend, they managed to score. They managed to score a goal, which
we were like, actually, we will let you score a couple goals.
Yeah, you know, it's only trial. Let your fans have something.
You know?
Exactly right. But make the most of it, because it's not happening in round one.
Absolutely. It's going to be, it's a Saturday night game.
Yeah.
It is at Albert and Oval, which is a bit of a shame, but
so put some locks on your hubcaps, lock your cars, no valuables in there.
Safety in numbers, guys.
And don't expect for your car to be there when you return.
Pretty much. But no, I reckon we got this. So yeah, get your tickets. If you're a member, you can redeem your free ticket just to guarantee your entry.
Yep. Indeed.
Yeah, you might see us there. I mean, we will be there, but you might be lucky enough to see us.
Indeed, indeed. Now, we had a trial game against Port as well on Saturday. So that's what we referred to with the 3 wins in one day. We ran out winners, and I don't have the full score here, but it's 58-34 at the end of the game because the Crows decided not to post the box score at the end. But just, you know, a trial game down in Port Augusta.
Mm-hmm.
Just went down there, got the job done. Probably didn't mean too much, but a good first hit out for the girls as they look to take on another season and, you know, hopefully push themselves deep into the finals. So a good performance. The photos of Ebony Marinoff on the full-time post, I'm sure she probably had about 85 disposals. And
you know, I'm sure she did. I'm just waiting. The internet's not my friend today because I feel like that they posted something more.
An in-depth
analysis, I'm sure.
Indeed, there probably is something on there.
Oh, hang on. Here we go.
As we just, as Soph Keep looks for that, that. It's... Here we go.
Who impressed?
Here we go.
Give me a minute. It's loading. It's loading, guys. A loading error. That's exactly what you don't want to see. Hang on. No, we're coming back.
Thank you for joining us on this ride. As we look for an AFLW trial.
All right.
Notes. Here we go.
So we defeated Port by 24 points. We made the most of the breeze in the second and fourth term. We won 8 goals 10, 58 to 5 goals 4, 34. Bit of skim reading here. Defenders Zoe Prowse and Chelsea Bedell held strong down back all afternoon. Love to hear it. Adelaide's first year players, Brooke Boilio, Lily Tarlinton and Tamara Henry all had their first professional hitouts. And they were all very impressive by the sounds of things, which is good. Hatchie was at her ball winning best. Clean by hand and strong on both the inside and the outside.
What about in the middle?
Inside and outside.
Please ignore
Hang on. Next sentence. Hatchard applied her trade through the middle, but it was her ability to go forward and hit the scoreboard, which was most impressive.
There we go. So she was doing literally everything.
There was nothing more that she could do. She was just everywhere. Finally, the goal scorers. So we had 2 goals to Waterhouse and Hatchie.
Chopper.
And singles to Boilio. Sorry. Jones, Martin and Bedell.
Lovely, lovely. And of course, big Crom fan Jess Waterhouse, always posting TikToks in her Crom Po.
You love it. Very, very wholesome TikToker.
I love her account.
I only stumbled across her maybe a month ago.
Yeah.
I am obsessed. She's so cute. She does all these cute little, like, come with me and do this. And I'm just runs. Stop it.
Yep.
I'm obsessed.
Training for a marathon, come with me, doing my, like, prep for the lunch for work. It's just a good channel. In fact, I think, I can't remember exactly what her at is, but if you go on TikTok and search in Jess Waterhouse, it's just a good time. Hopefully some game day vlogs maybe or something coming up in the near future for the new season.
Yeah.
But anyway, that was the news. I don't think there's anything more that has come out in the time. Tex's injury has come out in the time since I've printed this run sheet. He had surgery on his eye today and will miss the showdown this week, which is disappointing because we know he loves to give Aaliyah an absolute bath in showdowns. But it's okay. We'll just pass the baton.
Sell a bit of candy.
Exactly. The left foot is always right, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
But we may see him back against Sydney, the article said, but we may not. We'll see how we go with that and depends how he heals, I suppose. Mm-hmm. Hopefully not a detached retina, which has, of course, wreaked havoc of another veteran of the club recently and forced some retirement.
No, they did say today it was some damage to the pupil.
Okay.
A thorough investigation found very minor damage to the retina and the specialist is confident that that occurred previously, so it wasn't related to what happened on field. He underwent surgery today to correct the small tear. And it's worth noting that his injury is very different to that experienced by Rory Sloane.
I love how they've put that in the article. Just be like, don't worry, guys. Calm down. He's okay.
Yep. And a decision on whether he returns for the Sydney game will be made following a further medical consult.
Okay. I have hope. I hope I'm going over there to at least see him play. I booked tickets in thinking it might be his last, but I just want him on the park at this point.
Make it worth it.
Indeed. And we'll move on to the SANFL now, mm-hmm. where the Crows defeated West Adelaide. That score is not quite right.
What is that score, Benjamin?
I think that was half the score from last week or something's happened. I've taken a call and just fucked up the typing.
It's supposed to be the same as AFL, as it says on the run sheet, because we finished on 111.
Indeed.
Were the goals and behinds the same, do you think?
Not quite, because
it
we had...
wasn't 17 goals 9?
Oh, actually, yes, it was the identical score. I thought you meant the goal scorers. So it was 17-9-111, which was the same as the AFL team. Whoa, pretend like you never heard the last 30 seconds before that. To West Adelaide, 6-7-43 in the Neil Curley Cup. Of course, commemorating a great of SA football, Neil Curley. I think we've won it each time we've played it in the last couple of years.
Yeah,
so,
probably.
Yeah, no, we've done pretty well. Westies looked good early. They were in front at quarter time, but we just sort of ran them over in the second half. And who were the main goal kickers, Soph?
Well, we had one guy that just could not get enough of the goals.
It's like he knew that there was a forward line spot opening up this week.
And he saw it and he just took it.
Yeah.
So we are, of course, talking about Lockie G scoring 8 goals.
8 straight as well.
Was it 8 straight? Mm-hmm. He cannot
miss.
Did
not miss.
Golly gosh. And then we saw 2 goals each to Burgess, Dowling and Jones, and singles to Edwards, Ryan and Strawny.
Indeed. Now, we cannot confirm or deny whether Gollant paid Tim English to smack Tex in the eye. I'm going to say probably didn't, but, you know.
Allegedly.
There's always a chance. He's kicked 8 and he's gone, yeah, you know, I could get a chance in the AFL side from this. Need someone to get out the way. Tex is gone. Gollant probably comes in. See if it's a coincidence. Now, the best, Charlie Edwards is going to be an absolute star for the Crows. He is just putting together a huge bulk of work in the SANFL. He had 31 touches, a goal and 9 clearances. Harry Schoenberg had 26 touches and 9 clearances as well. And Billy Dowling, despite being rested from the AFL side, had 21 touches and 2 goals. So he did himself, you know, no issues of potentially coming back this week, though. Don't know who he might slot in for, but he played a very good game. So, an all-around good performance for the SANFL. And I think we are steaming home towards the top 5 before finals. We may kick out your Eagles, who I think are also on the cusp at the moment.
They are sitting 5th based purely on percentage.
So the Eagles, North and the Crows are all tied on 14.7 wins. So, interesting. We've got 2 rounds left. The Crows play Port this week, obviously, in a doubleheader pre the showdown and finish off against Sturt, the ladder leaders. So, a tough finish to the year for us. The Eagles have South and Norwood, which is also a tough finish. This is going to be... The last round of the SANFL could really decide the final spot. So, it's very entertaining. And, Soph, who are you going to go for if the Crows and the Eagles are both looking for final spots? You got to stick with the Eagles, don't you?
Maybe. I don't know.
Don't you want the NOAA AFL and the SANFL crew to just really get up in arms again? That's always fun.
It is fun. That's why I'm like, the Crows winning would be funny because they get really angry.
If we bring Billy Frampton back for the final series, will you jump on board?
Oh, absolutely.
There we go.
Straight on board.
Indeed. So, Billy, if you're listening, you're not going to be playing AFL finals because Collingwood are out of those. Come back and just flip the bird to a few passionate SANFL fans when we make the finals there. Now, we will move on to the next game, which, of course, is the showdown. We have 1 forced out in Tex. I probably can't see anyone else dropping out of the side.
No.
The performance was too good to be dropping anyone. I don't think anyone else was injured. Everyone played pretty well. So are we in agreement that Tex is probably the only change this week?
I think so. I did get a little scared towards the end of the game when Murray looks like he tried to knock himself out. very stressful. I think he's okay. Nothing's come out. So
yeah, haven't heard anything.
No. The injury report loves to come out on a Tuesday. So
indeed.
If you're listening, you may already know. But no, hopefully he's okay. Because that back line definitely needs him.
100%.
But yeah, at this stage, I reckon just Tex.
Yeah, probably Tex for Gallant would be the only change I could see happening.
Surely that would just be a straight swap.
Yeah, yeah. We're probably going with three tools. I think that's probably the right mixture for it. So who do you think is going to win this week, Soph? And how much and who is kicking our best goal?
All right, we're just going to go straight in and say the Crows are winning by 23 points.
I love it.
And the best goal is going to be Rochelle.
Yeah, I like it.
Rash.
I like it. Big stage.
And then there's going to be a bit of biff afterwards because we can't help ourselves.
A bit of biff.
A bit of biff. Bring the biff back.
Indeed, but please don't bring it to the hill around me because despite talking a massive game, Jack Hud's in the Patreon's chat, it just wouldn't happen. So
there might be biff everywhere, but it's fine.
There may be. In fact, if you want to see some social content biff, Jack and I actually recorded a promo video for this showdown at the previous showdown for Neds.
That's what this is about.
It's not going to be a great performance for me. Let me just preface that right now. I was a bit camera shy. We had a few people run in on the video. It just did not turn out so well. So hopefully my performance is not an indicator of the Crow's performance, but it will be a bit of good fun. I don't actually know when that's coming out, but we recorded it like 5 months ago and they said it'll come out for this round. So
Ben shitting himself, basically.
yeah, 100%. I'm really hoping they've just canned the idea and it just does not come out because it was pretty bad. But keep an eye on the Ned's Facebook page or socials or somewhere and you may see my face somewhere. And a crombeanie. A crombeanie will be there. So
if it pops up, I'm sure we're going to share it. So keep an eye out.
I'm very much prepared to be absolutely rinsed by multiple group chats this week when I randomly pop up in that video, but it's okay. It's fine. I think we get the win. I'm never going to tip against us in a showdown, so of course I'm going to say that. But we've got the wood over them at the moment. The boys are rolling pretty nicely. We're in decent form. So I think we come in and win. We win by 9 points. I think it'll be a little bit closer. And I've got Rankin kicking the best goal. He loves these games.
He does. He loves the big stage.
Three so far. He's going to give us another. It's our house. He's going to shush the crowd or something.
Hang on a minute.
Oh, you mean just like that?
He's going to give us one of these.
So again, head to youtube.com/Crowject to see. But Sophie's ever famous Isaac Rankin, our house, solely designs, design sign, is on display at the moment. And we're thinking that he may give us one of these on Saturday night and just really shut the ferals up because it is a Port home game. It is sold out. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be an absolutely bumper crowd and it's just set for Isaac Rankin to do something special and just take over the game. So hopefully that happens and we are all happy and Port are not happy and Jack Hudson just leaves the chat because he's just having a bad time. Now, we are about to head over to Segment Street. So if you would like to hear us talk about Fantasyland, Around the Grounds, Beryl and Cecil of the Week and much, much more, including maybe a little bit more in-depth preview for the showdown, maybe we'll call Jack in Segment Street and just get his thoughts ahead of the game, head to patreon.com/Crowject. As I said earlier, as little as $1 a month, you get plenty of things. You get our pre-rolls, our Segment Streets. You get to get your crow on. You can name a game for Leighton to put up on YouTube and he'll do it. You get a whole plethora of things. So, of course, head over to patreon.com/Crowject. Follow us on all our socials, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube for the video version if you want to have a look at that and all of the things that we've referenced tonight. We're on TikTok as well, at Crowject. Thank you very much to our Patreons. Get your Crom merch at crowject.bigcartel.com. Thank you for joining me tonight, Soph. It's a dynamic duo. You've done better than Ray. Let's see if he listens to the pod.
Wow.
Let's see if he listens and gives me some feedback on that. So thank you for joining me this evening.
Thanks for coming as well, Ben, because I was sitting here for a few minutes by myself and thought it was going to be a full-on solo just pod. Sophie. Just a Sophie solo pod, but I got a friend.
I'd listen to a Sophie solo pod. That would be a good listen. Thank you very much again to our Patreons. Thank you very much to everyone for listening.
Absolutely.
Go Crom.
Go Crom.
And squash the pet.